good evening, and thank you very, very much for coming today. You guys have always been very supportive of all our initiatives, so I really appreciate that. So I'm sure all of you know, today is the second edition of our JFW Women's Summit. This is something we started last year, it was initiated last year, as part of our endeavor to raise awareness, create a platform for discussing various issues surrounding women. I mean, I think this is a month dedicated to women, so we came up with this theme, March for Change. So in our own way, we want to create a forum which will, we are hoping, you know, will create a change in everybody's mind, and I think that's the most important thing that we need in today. So Vidya is here. I think all of you have been waiting very anxiously, and she's here to talk about a topic that she's that's very close to her heart. And even as from JFW's side, we found her an ideal fit to be able to share her views and thoughts. So yeah, we're going to get started very soon. So if there's anything specific you want to ask her about the summit.
So many days you have to tell him. You are. Yeah. Naan pesha Tamil, Palakkad Tamil, ellarkum purima theriyala. Ana yeah, I've come to Chennai after very, very long. Y'all aren't inviting me often enough. Maybe that's the reason. I think it's been a couple of years since I last came. I, of course, passed through twice, once while going to Pondicherry and once while going to Tirupati. But besides that, I haven't been to Chennai. So when I was driving in, you know, there are memories that flood back from a long, long time ago. From when I was a child, and my father's sister used to live here. She's now in Bombay. But we used to visit them during the summer vacations. And going to Marina Beach. I remember being taken to Kamal sir's house as a kid because I was a huge fan. And I said, he apparently stayed close to my relative's house. So they said, okay, we'll take you to meet him. And I thought it was, you know, child's play to go meet whoever you wanted. We went there, he was obviously not home. But they gave us a picture signed by him, and I was so thrilled. So lots of these memories have been flooding back. But I think every time I come back to Chennai, and I have some friends here who I've worked with in the past. So it's always nice to be back. Only there's not enough time to shop.
You're doing
a
lot of ads, government
ads, and the social awareness ads you are doing. Yeah. Actually, this campaign was the Swachh Bharat campaign, which is the tagline of which reads, Jahan Soch, Vahan Shauchale, was shot for almost, I think, 3 years ago. But the media is being bombarded with those images, with sound bites, and with the ad campaigns now, and given that our Prime Minister has started the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, so I guess it's not new, but I'm so happy that this is helping further the momentum that has already been building here.
Given this platform that we're going to be speaking on today, yesterday Anushya Sharma was targeted for being present at that World Cup match. Do you think that was unfair?
Absolutely unfair. It's ridiculous, you know. I can't believe why can't people just say that, you know, especially in sports, there are good days and bad days, and sometimes you score a century and sometimes a double century and sometimes you come back with nothing. But that has nothing to do with another person's presence, you know. How long are we going to look for things to blame success, things or other people to blame success and failures on? And it's most unfortunate that, you know, Anushka, not because she's an actress, but I think just as a girl, as a girlfriend, it's really unfortunate that they're targeting her like this. I think it's unbelievable.
It's unfair.
Yeah, it is most definitely unfair.
You were also part of the delegation that met the IND minister.
Yeah.
So, are you happy with what he had to say? Are you looking for the sensible chief to resign?
No, I think, you know, that was not the real agenda of the meeting. The agenda, the minister called for a meeting with you know, various representatives, actors, producers, directors were all present there. And we just voiced various concerns to him. Because being the INB minister, I think he wanted to have a closer understanding of what are the real issues that we want addressed. And I think that was what it was. But the takeaway, I think, what came out, what one read was very, very myopic. Yeah, it's definitely a very hopeful scenario. He seems very open and receptive, and that can only bring good. Yeah.
Can you tell us a little about what you've been speaking about today?
You know, when she told me it was about body image issues, I was more than happy to be here because I'm someone who's dealt with that for the longest time and continue to be targeted for, the way I'm built or for my structure, for my body, for losing weight sometimes, for gaining weight sometimes. I really think there's more to me than my body. And thankfully, of course, I'm not saying that those parts aren't written about, but I just think overall there's too much focus on the body, which is why when Veena asked me, I more than readily said, I'm happy to be here.
And my team and I were just talking, like, you're so perfect. I really don't understand.
Oh my
why.
God. Thank you. Thank you.
You're just fine. So it's going to be like a discussion. So, you know, as a discussion keeps happening.
Indian women are marching towards change. This is all about march towards change. Do you think Indian women are marching towards change?
Most definitely. In, I think in, firstly, they're entering and entrenching themselves in what used to be male bastions before. I think we're taking charge of our lives, making our own choices, being unapologetic. The march is happening, not to say that there are no ills in society and we're not being mistreated, we're not being wronged, but change is never absolute. And each step counts, so we're all slowly taking baby steps so that more and more of us can feel empowered and can bring about a change in our own lives before we do it for anyone else.
Yeah. Which things we have to do the importance in one hand? Only for grammar, only for fitness or other thing is something. So any special things in one hand?
Yeah, of course. I mean, I think our magazine, JFW, I can speak for JFW only. And what we feel very strongly, and I think what our readers also believe, that we are a right mix of style and substance. Every issue we do that. I mean, women, as she said, is a amalgamation of everything. So the beauty is definitely there, so we can't ignore it. So there is fashion, there is beauty, there is health and food. But there, we also go after stories which are like our March issue. I don't know if you had a look at a March issue. We did a cover story with the Indu Mukund, who's the martyr of, wife of martyr Major Mukund. So we do go after stories. I mean, we like to show our readers that there are women like that who dealt with situations like that and how strongly she has emerged. And yes, there are a lot of social organizations, causes. Even when we do stories, cover stories with the stars, they could be sports people, they could be from cinema. We don't just keep doing the routine stuff. I don't know if you've read our cover stories, but that's what everybody has told us. You know, they always get to know a little more about the artists, what they actually feel from inside and what kind of a people they are. So that's what we specialize in.
When do we get to see you doing a South Indian film?
Oh my God. I don't know. I'm looking for the right script. You know, it would obviously be a dream to do a good Tamil or Malayalam film, or Tamil and Malayalam film. But, because that really is my mother tongue. But I haven't found the right script yet. When I do, I'll be more than happy to do a Tamil film or a Malayalam one.
You guys will see more female-centric roles in Bollywood, given that, you know, Kavita has just won the National
Award for. Yeah, and NH10 is doing very well. So I definitely think, there is that change happening. I have experienced that change. in the past 5-6 years, I've received loads of scripts, or rather more scripts that are female-centric. And, you know, 2 years ago, when The Dirty Picture, when Kahani released, it was still looked at as an aberration, but slowly that aberration, mm-hmm. I think, will become a norm. I'm not saying in the next 1 or 2 years, it will still take time, but these roles are being written for women, these films are being written, and the important thing is that these films are engaging and entertaining. So, you know, that's what makes it more accessible to people. Because you did have female-centric films, maybe in the 80s and 90s also, but maybe they didn't do as well, which discouraged people from making more of these films. But today, these films are doing well, because there's great storytelling. These films are very engaging. They're not just unidimensional, where women are being portrayed as sacrificial goats, or, you know, either being glorified or vilified. None of the sort. It's about real people, which is why the connect is that much more. And therefore, as more of us go out and conquer the world, I think films will also, will obviously reflect that.
After marriage, you're not signing many movies, one movie a year and all. So is it to maintain the work? Like
no, not at all. I've always done one film a year. It's since, always isn't since about 2008. But it so happened that the releases would get timed such that they would release back to back. That I didn't have control over. But I've, since 2008, I've been doing just one film a year. I like to enjoy life outside of the set also, so that I can bring back to a role or to the film that much more. You know, I think that experience is very valuable to me.
Do you have any new project of biography of
Suchitra Sen? No, I think there's some misinformation that I'm doing the Suchitra Sen biography. I'm not. A biopic,
but
I'm not. Yeah, I was shocked to hear that I'm doing it. Though it would have been an honor to play her, because I love her, but it didn't work out. I'm
so
not doing it.
There is any choice, you have
to
act.
No, it didn't work out. You don't. Yeah, that's all I can say.
So now we have to take Vidya away, because you have to start the party.
Thank you all.
Thank you all so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Paloma, and I'd like to welcome you all to the JFW Women's Summit. It's wonderful to have you all here. As you all know, the JFW Women's Summit is a JFW magazine initiative, and after the amazing success of the summit last year, we are proud to present it to you in its second edition. And I think a lot of the repeat faces here lead me to not say too much on that subject, because I suppose the facts speak for themselves. So before we begin, I think that we should give the JFW team a big round of applause, because I've worked with them closely and I know how much this means to them. So congratulations, Bina and Sujit, once again. And they've had many, many events through the year. So we'll tell you a little bit about that as we go forward today. So I would like to say a little bit about JFW, not because I've had the opportunity to work with the entire team closely, but it's safe to say that they're South India's leading women's magazine. They've got a circulation in 19 cities and a readership of over 2 lakhs. So apart from covering all of the major cities in South India, JFW is available in Delhi, Mumbai and Pune with a very strong online and digital presence as well. And to share a little bit about the group behind JFW, the Options Media Group, a leading media company and the publisher of JFW. They also publish the widely distributed luxury lifestyle magazine, Club Class, reaching the members of 31 premium clubs across South India, making it the only magazine in India to reach 6 lakh plus high net worth readers. Both the Options Media Group and JFW believe in bringing you a quality product that is from the heart. And let me say that it's not just about the numbers, but also about reaching out to people in a real way. They're proud to be associated with and a voice for various walks of life, women who are special in their own way, those who are our everyday heroes, and those who make a difference. In honoring such achievers, JFW has pioneered highly respected initiatives like the JFW Women Achievers Award, which has completed 7 editions, and now, of course, the JFW Women Summit that was initiated last year. Now, I'm sure I speak for all of us here when I say that being a woman is a privilege. The ability to create new life, to influence thoughts, to build careers, there are endless reasons to raise a toast to women. Yet, there are constant efforts by regressive minds to pull down, to violate, and to objectify women, even while trapping them in archaic stereotypes. So finding a way out demands debates and discussions and taking a stance. So the purpose of the JFW Women's Summit, with the underlying theme March for Change, is to bring together a selection of eminent panelists who, with their vast repository of knowledge and experience, can share their thoughts and opinions and guide us towards making informed decisions and marching ahead. Of course, ladies, and a couple of the gentlemen that we have here, not to leave you all out, none of this would have been possible without the support from all of our sponsors, so I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge and thank them. Our associate sponsors, Green Homes and Deepika Fashions, let's give them a big round of applause and keep it going. Our hospitality partner, Sheraton Park, our luxury partner, Volvo, and of course, our gift partner, VBJ. Let me once again say thank you so much. And now before we move forward, we have a quick video that will tell you a little bit more about JFW and today's event. So ladies and gentlemen, please turn your attention to the screen. We'll be right back. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to call upon the driving force behind JFW and the editor-in-chief, Beena Sajid, to further welcome you all. Let's give her a big hand, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to the second edition of our JFW Women's Summit. This is a very special day for us at JFW. We started this initiative last year with loads of positivity and enthusiasm. And today, we are excited at the proportion our second edition has reached. Through this summit, as you just saw in the AV, we aim to raise questions, find solutions, change perspectives, and take a stance so that women can make informed choices and continue their march towards progress. There are countless issues surrounding women that need talking about. I wish I had all the time and resources in the world to cover all of them. Unfortunately, I don't. So when it came to choosing the topics for today's panel, it did not take us long to pick two of the most prevalent areas that needed our attention and discussion. The first one on the table was women and body image. It's a silent plague that's been affecting women of all ages all over the world. Not so long ago, I was out shopping for some clothes, and I saw something very disturbing. There was this girl, say max 18 or 19 years of age, who had just come to pick up some jeans. I mean, she chose one. She just held it against herself, stepped back, looked at herself in the mirror, and then she exclaimed, "Oh my God, why do I freaking have buckets for hips?" And a friend who was with her nodded in approval. She took home the whining trophy for the worst body image that day. Mind you, in my eyes, she was perfectly fine and fit for her age. And what she said made me angry for two reasons. One, at that age, she had no business rubbishing her body the way she did. And two, thanks to her, I was no more excited about the new Chinese restaurant I was going to go out with my family that night. Later that day, I realized that it's not about one's age or one's size. And too few women are perfectly content with the way they look. There's a set of us who is always complaining how grotesque the flab under our arms is. And on the other end of the spectrum are some who resent the fact that they look like a sack of bones. When it comes to the body, the grass is always greener on the other side. We've been afflicted by the standards of beauty set for us. It's a sin not to have perfectly toned arms and washboard tummies. So from where and how did the phenomenon of body bashing begin? Did it begin when I was a kid because my mother fed me well and ensured I got all the nutrition, while a few friends disapproved of when my hips grew a few inches wider? Is it the media? Because we are always trying to fit ourselves into the world we borrow from models featured in magazines and television channels. But there were no glossy magazines or television shows in the 16th and 17th century Europe where women wore body-hugging corsets to elicit a certain body shape. Our panel is here today to discuss why, as women, we are constantly longing to be in somebody else's shoes, body-wise, and what we can do to create a universal, healthy body image. The other topic we are going to focus on today is, can women have it all? It is perhaps something that has been talked about way too many times, but I think it's not enough. There are times when I feel I've had a completely productive day, absolutely proud of what I've achieved. But those feelings are always combined with a longing and a wish that I could have spent a little more time with my boys. The top line management in many companies has women at its helm, but what did they have to compromise on to get there? As women, we are known for our multitasking skills. So why not be the best boss and the best mom at the same time? When Indira Nooyi said, "Women can't have it all," many out there were outraged by her statement. Was it partly because she perhaps put things in perspective for thousands of accomplished women who were in denial? Raising children in this world means giving them the best of everything, and today, in most middle-class and upper-middle-class families, that is not possible with just one income. As women, we are also expected to contribute to the home kitty, to give our children the best and enjoy a certain lifestyle. How do we climb the career ladder without feeling guilty? Do we pen down our priorities, or do we create a coping mechanism as Ms. Indra Nui did for herself? Our panelists are here today to give us a realistic picture of whether women can have it all. Like each one of you, I look forward to hearing them share their point of view and their experiences. So let's get started. Thank you.
All right, we'd like to get right into the thick of things, and I'd like to introduce our moderator for this evening. He is someone you all know well and doesn't need too much of an introduction, but I'm going to give him one nonetheless. He's moved from the newsroom to the courtroom. As you all know, Sanjay Pinto is a man who wears many hats. He's a lawyer, he's a columnist, he's an author, he's a public speaking mentor and a former resident editor of NDTV 24/7, and he's the man who's got the tough job of being the moderator today right here on stage. So I'm sure it's going to be an exciting evening. Ladies, please put your hands together for the one, the only, Sanjay Pinto. Sanjay, I'm sure you're up for the task, and welcome back to the second edition of the summit. And now, without further ado, shall we move on to introducing the person everyone's been dying to meet, Sanjay? Shall we? All right. With the national acclaim such as Best Female Debut, Best Actress, and the Padma Shri, her proficiency in the entertainment industry is marked by widespread successes like Parinita, Pa, The Dirty Picture, Kahani, and has earned her a jury seat at the Cannes International Film Festival. Entertainment aside, she's worked actively towards social welfare causes such as child nutrition in India. Ladies and gentlemen, we're so honored she could be with us here today. Please put your hands together for the beautiful and talented Vidya Balan.
Good evening and welcome, Vidya. You know, they say men hear, but women listen. Don't just listen, but also question. So we'd like to make this as interactive as possible. I may be the moderator out here, but I've always believed that a Chennai audience is the best intellectual audience you can ever get. To see a house full on a Friday evening, right after a World Cup semi-final that many of you would have watched, at the cost of your offices, and to see a house full really is, I think it's a finest tribute that you can pay to the cause and to JFW that's been doing so much of late. Vidya Balan is somebody I haven't interviewed when I was in NDTV, and that was one regret that's been taken care of today. Vidya, many say that, you know, you're happy to be a star, but you'd much rather be an actress, and a discerning one at that.
I think I've always wanted to be an actor. That is true. Because I feel stardom follows. You can't chase stardom. So I never have. I knew that stardom was a byproduct of being an actor. And the only thing I've ever wanted to do was be an actor, which is why, you know, I chased that and everything else followed through, and even better than I could have imagined. So I didn't waste any time imagining what that would feel like.
All right. I would like the audience to give me an answer for a change. You know, many of you are here because of the choice of panelists today. I mean, they are not just celebrities. They're all role models drawn from all fields. Now, Vidya Balan is somebody who was born in Kerala, lives in Mumbai. Born in Mumbai, okay. But with roots in Palakkad.
Yeah.
But yet, there's a sense of ownership when it comes to Chennai. They feel Vidya Balan is our girl. She's the girl next door. Would anyone in the audience tell me why? We also have prizes. I mean, the prize for the best answer that Bina Sujit will sit in judgment over is a selfie with Vidya Balan. You can't get a selfie otherwise because she'll be leaving at what, 6 o'clock? Your flight to catch? Yeah. So selfie with Vidya Balan. I was about to say maybe shake a leg with her on stage. I'm not sure. But anyone in the audience? She's Tamil. No, this is not a quiz question. I want to know why you feel that she belongs to us, that Vidya Balan is our person. She speaks Tamil. Yeah. She's got the girl next to her image. Beena, Sujit, you've got quite some judging to do now. Sorry,
ma'am? She's
ma-
a?
She dresses gorgeously like South Indians.
Wow, I'll have to agree with that, yes.
Thank you for the compliment.
Okay.
I love Kanjivaram saris.
We'll come to that, in fact, how you've championed the cause of weavers as well. But yeah. Good, thank you very much. Beena, you can do the judging. But Vidya, I mean, you've said in the past that you almost feel like in your previous life you were Bengali.
Mm-hmm.
Because many of your films, be it Paranita or Kahani, you know, they had an, you know, a Mumbai sort of a Bengali ambience. How does it feel to hear this from your Chennai fans?
Of course, you know, I am Palakkad Ayyar. I think that's why some people say I'm Malayali, some people say I'm Tamil, because we belong to both places equally, or both we don't belong equally. So it's not surprising that they feel like that. I hope they feel like that, you know, because I feel like that. I am a Palakkad Ayyar, Tam Bram, as they call us. Na Tamil la kodi pesha mudiyum ana ungalku puriyadhu nenikiren.
Yen Tamil enak perumai mattavukku poramai. I've been Karunanadi all my life, so I can manage.
No, ana na pesra Tamil Palakkad Tamil, neenga pesra Tamil Chennai
Tamil.
Sen Tamil.
Oh, just kidding, guys, but
no, so
shall we continue the interview in Tamil? I can give it a shot.
No.
Some of them know about my Tamil, so...
No, I'll be happy to speak in the Tamil. I do, but I think it'll become a little too... I don't know. Let's try.
Might make it a box item in the tomorrow, but... Coming back to your film career, Vidya, I will steer clear of the dirty picture for now, because
yeah.
We reserve that for the panel discussion.
Right.
How does it feel to play these, you know, to be a protagonist in the movie, especially when you're able to put... eclipse the role of the hero and to make them like... gravy by the side also ran.
It wasn't a conscious choice, honestly.
But you chose your roles.
Yeah, I chose my roles because I think I'm a very greedy actor. And when I got really juicy parts in great scripts, I didn't want to shy away from them. And I am the most important person to me, you know. So if in a film that's, as an actor... if I'm getting the opportunity to do the same, why not? I'm not someone who feels that I should only do films where, you know, there is a big male actor. And even if I have to play a subsidiary role, I'm greedy about what I am doing. And invariably, those are the kind of films where, like you said, the eclipse. I'm just a greedy actor, yeah. I think I can just put it down to that.
Okay, and a very good one at that, everybody
Thank
would,
you.
Would say. There were films where you kind of swerved, perhaps, from your chosen path.
Yeah.
Many believe. For instance, Hey Baby, Kismet Connection. And I've read that your sister and brother-in-law had to actually sit you down, and then you had a little discussion. Then you realized that, listen, I don't want to be doing these roles. I need to go back to what I'm really good at.
Yeah,
was
I think
so. Was that a course correction that you made in your career at some point?
Yeah, you know, because at that time when I did Hey Baby and Kismet Connection, I think I was trying to fit in desperately. I'm not your conventional heroine. And I think I came in believing that was a strength. Or I just came in being myself, and then I was made aware of the fact that that was probably a strength. But along the way, you know, you have... This is the kind of place where you have everyone commenting on every step you take. Fraternity, media, your fans. And somewhere along the way, you get confused. My only dream, like I said, an actor. I come from a complete non-film background. So when I got this opportunity and I saw success, and it was just not success, it was success after success after success, suddenly... it's human mentality, you know. Fear began to grip me that what if I'm not able to sustain this? And there were people who were telling me that, you know, unless you play the regular heroine, you're not going to be able to sustain yourself just doing these different types of roles. So that's when I think I came under pressure and I started doing those films, and I got slapped around by everyone. Everyone was, I had people telling me to my face wherever I went, you know, whether it was at the airport or whether, you know, I met people at a salon. Everyone was saying, what are you doing? Why are you doing these kind of roles? And I was like, you know, why are people telling me this? Every day I opened the paper, someone was commenting on my weight, which we shall, of course, discuss in the panel discussion. But weight, clothes, my personal life, all of which was stemming from the fact that I was doing something wrong on screen. You know, they were not connecting with me anymore. They realized that I had lost my way. So that's when I think I was going through a lot of confusion. I was feeling low, and my sister and brother-in-law, who are very strong influences in my life, they sat me down and said, you know, what are you here to do? And I said, I'm here to act. So they said, just do that. Everything else, you know, will follow. You can't operate from a space of fear. You're getting great opportunities. Let that be the defining goal for you, just to be an actor, to play great parts. And I think something in that conversation just, you know, made a lot of sense. And I said, okay, I'm just going to do what my heart says. Because as an actor, a lot of times there were roles that I felt like doing, and then I'd say, no, but maybe this won't be appropriate. But it's not really a big hero film. Or I'm not going to look, you know, great. It's, again, a plain Jane type of girl. And I put all these considerations away and again began to look at my work from a purely selfish, greedy actor point of view. And that's where I think the change happened. And
the fact that, you know, you said that the camera is your biggest confidant.
Yeah.
I mean, that's where your confidence stems from.
Yeah, I think so. The camera is my biggest confidant, my soulmate. I think the camera sees what no one else manages to.
And this is something that you've honed over the years, because I believe that, you know, when you were, you know, probably in school or college, you used to stand in front of the mirror, yeah, and belt out those dialogues. Shabana Azmi's dialogues from Arth, where she's supposed to tell Smita Patil, you know, leave my man alone or something.
Yeah.
You hadn't heard of glycerin those days, so the part involved, you know, activating your tear glands.
Yeah, absolutely. I didn't even know of something called glycerin, you know. But I had seen the film and I was extremely influenced by Shabana Azmi's performance and by the film per se. So I would go up to study on my friend's terrace, because they had a sort of a place where we could. So I would go there and I would not be studying. I would repeat the scene again and again, trying to see if I'm able to cry. And the day I'd be able to cry, like, you know, easily, I'd be able to study better. And the day I couldn't, I'd just keep at it and my studies would go for a complete toss. And also I would dance to Ek Do Teen in front of the mirror, you know. Because Arth, of course, I saw much later, much after it had released.
Give them a sample of that.
Oh my God, no.
Without the tears, of course.
Oh God, this is, I never expected, no one's ever asked me to do this.
I usually ask questions that others don't.
Yeah, so. I realize. She says, okay, I'm just going to say one
whatever,
line.
Yeah.
She just keeps repeating, she says, Kavita, tum sun rahi ho na? Huh? Tum sun rahi ho na, Kavita? She says it so beautifully. Oh my God, you know, I can't do it. I can't do it. But it's just, she keeps saying, she's so insecure about the fact that she may have hung up on the other side. She's keeps saying, tum sun rahi ho na? Indar ke alawa meri zindagi mein aur koi nahi hai. Mera koi nahi hai. Kavita, tum sun rahi ho na? Just that sun rahi ho na, you know, seeing that helplessness, that desperation of a woman trying to hang on to what she believes is her life, her marriage, was...
That's amazing. Now, you've...
Thank you. That was a terrible imitation. Sorry, Shabana Azmi. Sorry, Arth.
You can also tweet. I mean, Paloma had asked you to put your phones on silent, but please, you can tweet. Don't be scared of tweeting. 66A has been thrown out. You won't be arrested. So please tweet. I mean, the fact that Vidya Balan just recounted her formative years. Vidya, you've also had your share of difficulties, and that's what's made you stronger.
Right.
I've read that, for instance, Chakram, this movie with Mohanlal, had to be shelved. And then there were 12 other Malayalam films that you had signed up for.
Yeah.
Again, went out of the window. There was a sort of a jinx that you had to break. And then again, your roles were filled in by Meera, Jasmine, and Trisha. That must have been really, an acid test. I mean, but you've had your baptism by fire, in a sense.
Yeah.
How did you come out of that? What did you go through at that point?
I don't think I even realized what I was going through initially, because one, I did Chakram. I came back after the first schedule and I thought, here I was living my dream, working with one of my all-time favorite actors. Kamal Hassan and Mohanlal are my, all-time greats. And I was working with one of them and I said, this really can't get any better. And then suddenly I hear the film has been scrapped. And in that interim, the word had spread that there is this girl from Bombay, but she's a Malayali girl, she speaks Malayalam. So I had gotten lots of offers. I'd been signed on to do close to 12 films. This film got shelved and slowly and steadily I lost each one of those films. And I wasn't even informed that I was being replaced or anything of the sort. I think maybe one gentleman had the decency to call me and say, we've just decided to go with someone more established.
What were they, superstitious or something?
Yeah, I think they felt that Mohanlal and the director of the film was also called Kamal. Incidentally, he's a very established Malayali director. And they had done 8 films together. This was a 9th film. All 8 films were super hits. It was people believed that nothing could have spoiled that partnership. So if that partnership has gotten sour, it's because of an external factor and they just pinned it on me, So I got thrown out of each one of those films, and then I was doing a film in Tamil, as a matter of fact, and I felt like that was not the kind of film I wanted to be doing. I felt uncomfortable because what had been told to me on the phone and what the film turned out to be were two completely different things. So I walked out of that. There were legal notices at the age of 22. I was dealing with, having to reply to those legal notices. It was just crazy.
No, legal note. You should have been suing them, right?
Yeah, exactly. But, like I said, we come from a non-film background. Already you feel that this is a big bad world of films. And you're treading cautiously. You don't know what is the right thing to do. Don't know your way around. And my parents are, really, they're completely removed from this world. So if they had fears about me becoming an actor in the first place, all of this was kind of convincing them that this is not for me. So I don't think slapping a legal notice and or sending any of them legal notices would have been unimaginable for us. I think what kept me going, though, was this mad passion, this burning desire to be an actor. I think I'm most comfortable when I'm someone else.
That's a paradox, because many say Vidya Balan, believes that being herself is a 24-hour job, and you're yourself. But yes, you also play different roles.
Yeah.
What was the most challenging phase for you? Was it these formative years, rejection, superstition getting the better of you in that sense? Convincing your dad, who said education first, films later.
Yeah. Actually, it was my mom. My dad,
They encouraged you, but they said only after the
break. Yeah, absolutely.
What was the most challenging phase?
I think the most challenging phase was not to lose faith in myself. I was doing a Tamil film out of which I got thrown out. And, I remember coming here with my parents when we heard that they were considering replacing me. And this was after I had gone through all those, losing those 12 films, that other Tamil film fiasco. So when I came here, the producer, he showed my parents some footage from the film and he said, Look at how she's looking. Can you blame me for wanting to replace her? And you know, what killed me was not what he was saying about me. That he said it to my parents angered me even more, because it's absolutely mean. It's another story that he came back to me as soon as Parinita had released and said, I made a mistake, can I make a big film with you now?
It's like what probably Mark Zuckerberg felt when he actually acquired WhatsApp, because those guys had gone to Facebook for jobs earlier. Yeah.
Right, exactly. So I think it was, for about 6 months after that, I didn't have the courage to look at myself in the mirror. And I've said this many times before, I felt very ugly. I felt inconfident about the fact that I would ever make it as an actor. I was questioning whether, you know, this was just another schoolgirl fetish that I had let go on for longer than it should have. I was just, I think, but prayer, I'm someone who prays a lot. So I think I would pray. My family and faith are the two things that kept me going. So I would completely break down, and then suddenly from somewhere, I'd feel like, no, you know what, let me give it one more shot.
You've been quoted as saying that you once walked all the way from
Nariman Point to Bandra. Yes.
In search of a role, and then you were also found praying and crying your eyes out in a Sai Baba temple.
Yeah. You know, I grew up in Chembur, which incidentally they call Mini Palakkad. Because there are so many Palakkad Ayyars there. So there's a Sai Baba Mandir very close to my place, which I've been visiting forever. And every time something like this would happen, I would go there, sit and say, you know, you've dangled the carrot in front of me. Now it's your responsibility to make this happen. And I would cry, and I would, you know, I would go at night, so there would be no one around. It was almost on the street. It was not a real structure for a temple. I didn't realize that there were people actually watching me. So at some point, I'd acquired the reputation of being wo ladki jo Sai Baba se bolti hai, because I would talk to him. I would actually talk to him. So I did that and walked from Nariman Point to Bandra just in the scorching Bombay heat in anger. Before I realized it, I was in Bandra and I said, oh my God, what have I done? You know, but I just wanted to let steam off, and I didn't know any better way, I guess.
Again, it's probably an occupation hazard, you know, being linked to co-stars, you know, rumors. What's the one rumor that's really shattered you?
The one rumor that shattered me was, it's in June I'll complete 10 years in films, but nothing's really got my goat, so to speak. Until last year, there were rumors about my marriage, which really were, to my mind, unpardonable and unacceptable. I just think people look for new things because I opted out of a film. They made it out to be something else, and they said, you know, my pregnancy stories are so common that when I really get pregnant, I won't believe it. But you know, if it was, so they said she opted out of the film because of that. And then when they got to know that's not true, they said, oh, actually there's problem brewing in the marriage. And that really angered me.
Kite flying, irresponsible.
Yeah, because also, on what basis are you saying that, one? And secondly, you know, my husband is not an actor. I don't appreciate him being pulled into any of this. I'm equipped to handle with...
Even actors are entitled to their private lives and their privacy.
No, absolutely. But I'm saying I don't care. I don't read anything. I don't watch anything. You say anything about me, I'll just... I really don't. It doesn't matter to me. But what upset me was they were using, you know, just our relationship, our marriage to trouble me, or I don't know what. I still don't know the point of it. That's the one thing that really angered me. I was simmering for 2 days, which is the longest I have. In that phase when I was going through a lot of criticism for bad dressing, you know, I would simmer for 2 days over a bad picture. But after that, I think this was, for 2 days, I was hopping mad. I just wanted to kill someone.
Okay. Your marriage itself, you made it very clear, and I'm glad you did, that it's not going to affect your acting career.
Yeah.
Probably one reason why you should be glad that you're not part of Tamil cinema, because it's almost a norm. The moment you get married, either you quit acting, or if you do make a comeback, you play the role of a mother.
Right.
Right? You're very clear about marriage not affect. Has it affected in any way in terms of the choice of roles that you will now take?
No. Someone asked me a few days ago, you know, whether I would do a dirty picture now, and I said, why not? You know, what changes? I'm as greedy an actor as I was before, but I've done the dirty picture, so you need to challenge me with something new now. So that's all I'm looking for as an actor, you know, and I think that understanding is very important. I think both Siddharth and I know what our work means to each other. So we would, we are only supportive of each other's efforts.
Wish you had stayed back for the second panel discussion as well. But you've also said that, you know, there's no retirement for an actor really, that you retire at 83 or something.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Still,
I'm hoping it's
not
true.
Not as bad as politicians, but still.
Yeah, I think once an actor, always an actor. If nothing else, I'll be acting in front of my mirror. You know, I can't not act. I hope there are roles in films for me to suit the age and stage of my life that I'm in at different points of time. That, I think, is very, very crucial, because a lot of times, you know, of course, like you quoted, you said that about Tamil cinema, it's not very untrue of Hindi cinema, it's just changing now. Aishwarya Rai is doing films, Kajol is doing films, Kareena is doing films, I am doing films. So,
but after a break?
They have come back, obviously because they had babies and therefore at that time they couldn't be. But, you know, I don't think marriage changes anything. I don't know if motherhood will. That that I think, because I've seen all actresses, that is like Beena was just mentioning, you know, you go through that guilt, and besides that you go through body trauma. So I don't know how, because you're expected to be in a certain frame or be looking in a certain way, I don't know how easy it will be when you're having a child, unless the role demands that, then you're just plain lucky.
Okay, you're somebody who's always done your homework before any role. I mean, you live the role literally. Like, for instance, you play the role of a radio jockey, you spend time with RJs. But for No One Killed Jessica, was it a conscious decision to not meet Sabrina Lal?
Yeah.
The producer's call or yours?
The director's call, actually. He just felt that, you know, Sabrina had gone through whatever she had 11 years ago. Mm-hmm. And today her entire perspective on it was very different. She was stoic and he wanted me to be vulnerable. So he didn't want me to meet her so that I wouldn't think of her current personality, because she's obviously a result of all the experience she's had through these 11 years, and we were starting 11 years ago. So that's why he said, don't meet Sabrina. So I just relied on the script and him
not
for that film.
Notes or
no, nothing at all.
Okay. Your auditions for Vidhu Vinod Chopra, I mean for Parinita, went on for several months. And until he was absolutely convinced that, look, you fit the role.
You know, yesterday, I must tell you that I was with the director of Parinita, Pradeep Sarkar. We were sitting and chatting, and he was recounting how what a time I had gone through testing for Parinita. Today it feels like, you know, so distant that I don't remember the pain. I don't remember that. I just knew that I'm going to do my best to get this film. And there were times when, you know, I felt like I was getting it, and then I was told, not yet, not yet, not yet. So this went on and on and on and on and on. I just knew this was, there was this one person, Pradeep Sarkar, who had faith in me. And until he had faith in me, I was not going to lose heart. So I think that's why I kept at it, and then I got the film.
It lasted about 6 months, is it?
Yeah, over 6 months. Not continuously, of course, but they would, like one day I remember doing, performing to a song, just close-ups. They wanted to see how I did the lip sync, how I performed a romantic song. Another day they made me do an emotional scene. Another day they made me do a more, you know, just a regular scene. So every time it was something new. By the time I reached the last test, which I didn't know was the last test, you know, if you've seen Parinita, that first shot in the film, when I turn back and it says Parinita, they tested me for that shot. I was so angry with not knowing whether I'm going to get this film or not, that when I turned, there was just, you know, damn you attitude in me. And Vinod Chopra says that, you know, he could see that. He could see that, and that's the reason he gave me the film.
So, earned your squares there. And
yeah. He, of course, believes that I used expletives for him, but that's not true.
You have taken up several social causes. Like, for instance, you're batting for weavers. And I think even at the Lakme Fashion Week, you wore a Kanchipuram organza sari.
Yeah, yeah.
What has drawn you to take up such causes?
Tamil Ponnapa. Kanchipuram is in my... No, really, Kanchipuram is in my blood, literally. And my idea of beauty somewhere comes from a woman clad in a Kanchipuram sari with kajal and a bindi, mallipu in the hair, jimiki. That's what beauty is to me.
That should have been the answer, actually.
Yeah, so, you know, for me, therefore, I've always loved saris. I've also seen my mum and my aunts and all wear cotton saris. So I've veered towards the organic handloom saris for a very long, long time. And I realized that, you know, when I chat with some of these designers, they tell me the kind of issues that these weavers are facing, how the power loom is a big threat, and
suicides and
all of that, you know. So I just felt that, and I realized that I was wearing hand looms without giving it a real thought for a long time. So I said, why not bring attention to this? Because then Lakme Fashion Week spoke to me, and they said, maybe we can do something around this. And, you know, this was the first step, and they said, can you come for one of the shows? And then Gaurang is somewhere I wear often. So that's how I landed up there. But besides that, I'm hoping to go meet some of the weavers. Just see how it works. You know, I'm very fascinated by that. Just not for anything else, out of pure interest. And then if something comes out of it, if that draws attention to the cause, great.
Okay. I've read another very amazing story about how you motivated a young bride in Varanasi to walk out of a marital home and demand a toilet in the house after your, you know, public service announcements and all that. That's something that must have been really heartening.
You know, that is very heartening. One, of course, because sanitation is very close to my heart. Cleanliness. I'm very finicky about cleanliness, and I'm very that's up there for me on my list of priorities.
You're part of Swachh Bharat also?
Yes, I am part of Swachh Bharat also. I've been nominated by Chanda Kochar. I practice that. There was a time when I hoped that I could go use a hose pipe and clean all the BEST buses in Bombay. You know, that's how finicky I am about cleanliness. So when I was signed up as brand ambassador, I was thrilled, but I didn't know it would have such far-reaching implications. One, the reach has been stupendous. It's just been really, they've penetrated really deep into the smallest villages all over the country. And when I read stories like this, it feels, I feel very fulfilled, because I didn't know what the outcome would be at that time when we did the campaign 3 years ago, as a matter of fact, two years ago.
You tried reaching out to that lady?
No, I haven't. But I met one of them. One such other woman was in one of the campaigns that we did. Okay. So in one of the ads that we did. But it's very interesting also because on my first trip to Varanasi, you know, I'm brand ambassador for Nihar, and we do this Chote Kadam Pragati Ki Or in Varanasi, in different villages, where they're educating children there. providing support. And I visit those villages once a year. So on my first visit there, they said it's 2.5 hours or 3 hours from the hotel. I said, fine. I reached there. And then on the way back, I said, you know, I want to use the washroom. And they said, there is no washroom. I said, what do you mean there is no washroom? They said, no, there's nothing. Bas kheti hai agar aap. I said, what do you mean? Kheti hai, main khet mein jaun. They said, haan, hum sab to yehi karte hain. I said, bhai, wah, ab. I was just conscious of, you know, one, not just of being seen like that, being photographed, worse still, you never know who is going to take a picture and WhatsApp it anymore. But importantly, that it was a fields, you know, it's these grains are probably reaching us. So I said, no, I can't do that. But at some point, I couldn't stop. I had to stop. I had no go. And then this came to me. Then when I read this story, I felt like, you know, this Swachh, yeah, it was coming a full circle, you know. This happening in Varanasi has that much more meaning for me personally. But I hope it inspires women all over the country. But what we also have to realize is that just building a toilet is not enough. A lot of places have toilets and no water supply. That's even worse.
Talk of Chennai, yes. Are you active on the social media? I've seen, I just checked that there are several. I think you have the most parody accounts. Are you really on Twitter?
No, I'm not
on Twitter. I tweeted yesterday saying, hi, we'll be catching up with you on Friday. I don't think I got a response. But then the tweets are almost as if you're tweeting yourself.
No, not at all.
Somebody is really doing a good job with that.
I've heard. So I've been told to get on Twitter for the past 5 years. My manager has been trying to get me on Twitter, but in vain. So
why don't you open a Twitter account right here at the JFW event here in Chennai, and you'll be given a round of applause by all the wonderful ladies out there. Why don't you open a Twitter account, ma'am, right here? And you can
do it, Priyanka. Yeah.
Come on, encourage her. Come on. Vidya Balan opens a Twitter account in Chennai at the JFW. I'm giving a headline.
Yeah.
My former media colleagues are outside. Anyway.
Yeah, absolutely. No, go ahead and do it. So I've been told by many people, because I'm not on Facebook, I'm not on Twitter, I'm not on WhatsApp even. You know, I know that that's the easiest way of communication today. So I think I love being around people. And I love one-on-one interactions, but I'm not sure I like just faceless people and probably nameless in a certain way because you don't know their real identity.
Yeah, there are trolls and all that. There is the downside.
So I'm a little cagey, but I am waking up to the kind of opportunities that Twitter or Facebook have in terms of
reviews. I mean, your movies. I mean, you would be happy to get some very discerning comments from your fans.
Yeah, exactly.
Who would like to stay in touch with you.
Yeah, and you know, wherever I go, like I told you, even in the smallest of villages, people tell me, Twitter account nahi hai aap, Twitter nahi karte aap, zara kijiye na, hum bhi aap se baat karenge. Then I feel like, you know, yeah, it's worth it. Maybe I should do it. So maybe soon. Maybe Priyanka, she's at it.
Yeah, she's at it. No, I don't think so. You know, my former colleague Srinivasan Jain, who we had met, I think, for this interview, Bombay Talkies.
Yeah.
Told me that when it comes to interacting with men, you like to interact with men who wear good shoes. Is that correct or was he making
really?
Up something? Yeah. Did you say that?
No, I did tell him that I love Gulzar Saab's mojdis. He wears these gold mojdis. And I love them. Of course, I love good shoes and nice.
The old shoes. Apparently, he said you gave him a stamp of approval as well.
Yeah. But I tend to observe shoes, I think, especially on men.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so he was right then. Okay.
Because there's not much in terms of clothing that you can really.
Okay. I won't probe further. Finally, I mean, for the benefit of all these lovely women out there, if you can actually belt out a few lines from any Tamil song. But before that, I want to put you on the mat. If you were to get a chance to act with two of the biggest stars in Tamil cinema, Rajinikanth or Kamal Haasan,
yeah,
who would you choose? Don't be diplomatic. You can take your time and think.
No, that's very unfair because
saying unfair is also being diplomatic.
No, because I will tell you this, that I told you this already, that I'm a huge Kamal Haasan fan, but I'm also a huge Rajni sir fan, but I don't see myself in his kind of films, unfortunately.
Okay.
But Kamal sir's films, yeah.
All right, so now coming back to the last, the icing on the cake, if you can belt any, you know, 2-3 lines of any Tamil song that you like.
It's a very old song.
Yeah, any song is fine.
And I don't know if I'm singing it right also, but this is my all-time favorite. Like, when I want to make myself happy, I sing, Aditate Ambujata Patela Avarat Kare Kunji Nata Ketela Archalum Purcha.
She deserves an applause for that. Actually, she...
Thank you.
No, such... You know, for most part of my career, I've interviewed politicians and all that. It's so refreshing to interview somebody like you. A complete interviewer's delight.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My only regret is that this is not on television. That's my only regret, but well, I have no control over that.
But she'll upload it, so it'll be on YouTube, yes. And you can everyone can watch it.
And you can tweet the link on Twitter from your new account.
Yes, absolutely. That's a promise, Sanjay. But genuinely, I've enjoyed the interaction, so thank you.
Me too. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
What about questions from the audience for Vidya?
Yes.
Okay, endorsement. Okay.
That's sorry, but rombave or South Indian question cater kinga. Enna paisa tarala chumma dana. No. No, I understand. No, it is completely pro bono.
Okay.
It is.
All right. Yes, any more questions, please?
That's the least I can do for the cause.
Also, in terms of, you know, what makes you tick really to make you the strong woman that you are, do you have a secret mantra? Something that makes you Vidya Balan?
I think two things, my family and my love for myself. That's probably it at the end of... You know, there are days when I feel a little... but finally, I come back to saying, no, yeah, I'm fine.
Good. Thank you. Thank you very much, Vidya. Stay on here because we've got a panel discussion as well lined up.
Thank you.
Sure. Sorry, ma'am. Yes.
Sorry.
Is that okay with you?
Yes, of course.
Yes, ma'am. You can shout out your question. If a mic can be passed to you, please.
No, you know, I have a stylist by the name Jayati Bose. So she calls for saris from different designers. And then I decide what to wear. But I also pick up, so she does a great job. But she knows my tastes very well. And I also pick up saris from wherever I go. I get gifted lots of saris. So a lot of times, you know, I'm wearing... Yeah. Really? Thank you. I must tell her that. Thank you, because I think that's because I love the sari. I could sleep in a sari. I could jump in a sari. I could do action in a sari. So sweet. Thank you so much. Thank you. You've made my day.
I think she deserves. I mean, if I can nominate someone for a selfie with Vidya, I think it should be ma'am. Selfie with Vidya. Is that okay, Veena? Selfie with Vidya. Right here, right now. Like the Oscars, yes. Thank you. That was such a sweet thing to say. Thank you. You really made her feel good about it. Yes.
Okay, Sanjay, I think we're ready to move on, but one last question from this lady who's had her hand up for a really long time, and then we'll move forward.
I'm a huge fan of yours.
Thank you.
And I want to know from you, how was the experience working with the superstar Amitabh Bachchan and mothering him in Pakistan?
Firstly, I must tell you, you look lovely. I like your sari, your jewelry, just very
Anita,
nice.
Anita Badani, right?
Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. It was funny initially. It was unbelievable. I remember telling Balki, you know, I think you've lost your head. What have you written? And you're asking me to play Mr. Bachchan's mother. And he said, no, I am asking you to play Mr. Bachchan's mother and Abhishek to play his father. So then I said, okay. I kept telling him that I need interaction with, I need to read the script with Mr. Bachchan a few times because, you know, like you would with your child, you're very uninhibited in your body language with your child, right? So I was scared of how I would just, if I could just like tap him or... He didn't give me time. Balki didn't. He chose, you know, not to really give me time with him. He probably felt that was better in case I get intimidated. But one day before the shoot started, we did a look test. And when we did the look test, and Mr. Bachchan emerged from the makeup room as Oro, I don't know what it was. It was one of those magic moments. I felt like he belonged to me. I guess that's what the suspension of disbelief really is. It happened, and then, you know, I never saw Mr. Bachchan without makeup through the duration of the film because I didn't want to remember that he was Amitabh Bachchan, who I had grown up watching. Absolutely. And loving.
And you were simply but we said magical in that role, I must say.
Oh, thank you.
You know, the way you performed it, being on the same frame with, and you were not a very established, that
right,
much of an established
right.
actress at that moment, and spellbounding, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
And I definitely would demand a selfie.
She demands.
Sure. Should I make it good afternoon because it's... Good evening, Chennai.
All right, so congratulations to all of the, well, selfie winners, I suppose. And I guess they got what they came for. So we'd like to now move on with introducing our two other panelists who will be joining us on stage for our first session. In the meantime, let's give Vidya a big round of applause. She was nice enough to do everything, I think, sing for us, almost dance for us. And thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Sanjay, it's your call, but I don't know. I think we're pretty packed. We'll have some questions at the end of this session, right?
We can be different from the ones they ask in Parliament, yes. Short question, please, yeah.
Throughout the shoot and throughout the promotions, you know, I was enjoying it. I remember when I was shooting in Calcutta first, and there were some people, some locals who actually pulled out a chair for me in a small little street thinking I was pregnant. So I said, this is working out well, let me take advantage of it. But jokes apart, I think a girl just knows how, even when you've not been pregnant or you've not had a child yet, you just know how it feels, yeah. So I could, I enjoyed the process. I enjoyed walking around everywhere with that. And I would huff and puff even though there was no weight. Just act.
I must say in that movie, till the end, even we were like, on the edge of the scene, that we were pregnant only in this, that oh God, pregnant and still really, you were marvelous.
Thank you. That's, you know, really credit to Shujoy Ghosh.
You want to come and take a quick selfie? So I think the quality of questions, really, I think I'm really impressed with the quality of questions. Many journalists in the making here.